See Duke take on Wake Forest. Some of you will see Wisconsin and Indiana. Then it's golf with third round coverage of the Nissan Open. The hottest player on the tour, Davis Love III, didn't let soggy conditions at the Riviera Country Club dampen his streak. Love shot a 4-under round of 67 yesterday to share the lead with Miguel Angel Jimenez of Spain through two rounds. Tiger Woods hold this 8-foot putt for an eagle at 17. That leaves him 4 shots off the lead. In college basketball news, Oklahoma junior guard J.R. Raymond, the Sooners' main offensive threat down the stretch of this season, has been suspended indefinitely for an unspecified violation of team policy. He will not play today against Maryland. Raymond was suspended earlier in the season on charges of shoplifting. That's all for now from the Fidelity Investment CBS Sports Desk. Stand by for Duke at Wake Forest or Wisconsin at Indiana. I'll see you at the half. Enjoy the games here on CBS.
This has been the Fidelity Investment CBS Sports Desk.
With the Duke Blue Devils and the Wake Forest Demon Deacons, fierce ACC rivals. Mike Krzyzewski has his Duke team fired up for the postseason. After a loss a week ago, the Blue Devils have sent a convincing message with two overpowering wins. They've retired Shane Battier's jersey number, but hardly retiring is his manner as he spirits Duke down the home stretch of this basketball season. Coach Dave Odom's Deacons are 18-8. They're home on Senior Day, and his talented troops are primed for an upset victory celebration. Wake Forest, Duke, next on CBS. And welcome to the Lawrence Jewell Coliseum in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. Third-ranked Duke, 22nd-rated Wake Forest in an ACC battle. Plenty of excitement and emotion today. Hello, Dick Enberg with Billy Packer. And to be in the nation's elite, you have to win on the road. Duke has some answers.
They really do. 24 straight on the road against conference foes. That's incredible. And a lot of it comes from that coach, Mike Krzyzewski. He has the mindset to go on the road and be effective. Of course, the last two ball games they played at St. John's, which we had, and look at what they did to Georgia Tech, a fine club, beating them by 44.
In high gear are the Duke Blue Devils. For the folks here at Wake Forest, that's been a hot and cold season.
Well, maybe not an overpowering team, but they've had some outstanding wins. And you can see right there, Kansas was a terrific win, Virginia, Georgia Tech. And those minuses are not so bad when you take in consideration who they've played.
Plenty at stake. Duke, Wake Forest, the starting lineups coming up.
The most dependable, longest-lasting trucks on the road. Microsoft, providers of software for the agile business. And by Fidelity Investment, we can help you see yourself succeeding.
Welcome back to North Carolina, Winston-Salem, Duke, and Wake Forest. Mike Krzyzewski of the Blue Devils, 5 wins away from 600 career wins. And he sends out this starting lineup today. They're just a game behind North Carolina for first place in the ACC. The front line of Mike Dunleavy, Carlos Boozer, and All-America Shane Battier, with Jason Williams, leading scorer, nearly 21 a game, and Nate James in the backcourt. Dave Odom won his 100th Atlantic Coast Conference game earlier this week. He's in his 12th season, and on Senior Day, he starts 3 seniors. Josh Howard's a sophomore, leading scorer. Josh Shoemaker and Rafael Vidaurreta from Spain are seniors, as is Robert O'Kelly, the 8th leading scorer all time at Wake Forest. He teams with Broderick Hicks in the backcourt. Patillo, Gordon, and shows the officials, and we're underway. Wake Forest and White will get the first chance.
Dick, something has to give here today in the fact that Duke is the best offensive team in the ACC. Wake Forest has the best record defensively.
Howard way off the mark on his jumper, and here come the Blue Devils, their first possession, and Jason Williams, brilliant sophomore.
Pick and roll, Wake Forest switching out front.
Dishes off to Battier, and Battier draws the much shorter Broderick Hicks.
That's the switch. Now you're going to have a mismatch in regard to size, and that should give Battier a lot of advantage on the offensive boards.
Williams misses his first shot. The loose ball ends up in Josh Shoemaker's hands and knocked out of bounds. Well, the first shot by Duke from three-point range. They lead the nation, nearly 11 trays a game made by this Blue Devils team this year.
40% of their shots are outside the three-point line. Straight man-to-man, a lot of pressure on that ball.
Around the perimeter, here's O'Kelly, who likes to shoot from outside, went through a cold stretch in January.
Dickey does like to shoot from the outside, but he's got a hard time getting that jumper off. James got a lot of size on him.
Senior Rafael Vidaurreta has the first points of the game from Zaragoza, Spain.
Pick up full court. Terrific reverse dribble by Williams.
Boozer outside to James. O'Kelly on him.
Vidaurreta does a fine job powering inside defensively. Very seldom gets called on fouls. That time he tries to help out on the switch and not there in time.
Boozer knocks down the miss by Battier, and it's tied at two.
Made things easy for Boozer that time.
O'Kelly from 16. And he gets the bounce.
Very important basket for Wake Forest. O'Kelly, a streak player, and has been playing very well offensively of late, but has games where he gets into some real droughts. So I'm sure Dave Odom gave a sigh of relief there.
This is Dunleavy. He's been on a shooting streak, averaging nearly 16 a game. Rebound, Vidaurreta. And here comes Broderick X, the junior from Houston.
With Vidaurreta and Shoemaker in there, Wake Forest ought to do all right on the rebounding.
And it's Williams the other way. Boy, can he fly. Tolden away. Batted by Howard. Ahead to Shoemaker. Around Battier, tipped it by Howard, and rebound Boozer.
I thought Shoemaker should have given that ball back to Howard. Howard had a much better angle at the basket.
4-2, Wake Forest early, 2.5 minutes into the game.
Dick, the pace of this game, though, is Duke's pace. They love to fly. Nice play, and there's Vidaurreta trying to play over the top.
Boozer with the easy basket has all four of Duke's points.
Duke University played in this arena, but not against Wake Forest in the NCAA tournament in one of the great games in the tournament last year, beating Kansas here, where Boozer was the star at the end.
Power drive by O'Kelly, rebound Vidaurreta, and the foul. A look at the Atlantic Coast Conference standings, one of the most competitive of conferences in the nation, with North Carolina leading by a full game. North Carolina and Duke will play a week from tomorrow in the season finale.
And Dick, if everything goes as expected, that game will probably give Duke its opportunity for a tie. If there's a tie, it moves down the line to Virginia. There is Rafael's parents.
Faustino and Maria Concepcion from the northeast of Spain.
Faustino was one of the leading high jumpers in Spain. And his son made a dunk yesterday, and he's not known for high jumping, so maybe he was trying to show his dad that he can get off the ground. Matter of fact, Dave Odom said that's the second dunk in his career.
He stopped practice, Odom did, so they could all appreciate Vidaurreta's move. Battier and a hold outside. I believe it was on Howard. Yes, his first.
Howard, that's his first. That's his first.
This is a potent offense. As you can see, only Billy Tubbs' TCU club beats them in terms of points scored. Duke, for the last 2 years, has led the nation in scoring.
Traveling the call against Nate James. Wake Forest with a two-point lead goes the other way.
They're trying to tie the all-time NCAA record of three straight held by Furman and Loyola Marymount. But Billy Tubbs' club keeps putting up the points, so I don't know if they'll catch them.
A 100-point-a-game team, the Horn Frog.
Sanders getting in the game very early here, and he's been playing well of late. Good shot block.
O'Kelly for three. Misses everything except the backboard. Batted around, and Dunleavy is fouled as he comes down with it as Broderick Hicks a hand in there.
Dick, I think O'Kelly would be smart against James, and Nate James guards the three-point shooter as well as anybody in the league. We'll see Dunleavy getting hit right in the chest. But I think that O'Kelly would be smart on James to try to penetrate with the dribble and get inside a little bit. It is tough to shoot over Nate James.
Casey Sanders now in the post for Duke, and Battier from outside. Whoa, what a rebound by Josh Howard, high above the rim.
probably quietly becoming one of the best players in the ACC and one of the top players in the country.
Took a bad shot there.
For years to come.
Terrific sophomores. There's a palm called against the star backcourt, Jason Williams of Duke. And with it comes a timeout. 15:44 left in the opening half. And welcome back with our Fidelity Investment Keys to Success. Billy?
Well, Dick, Duke University improved their free throw shooting. It's not that on the year it's been bad, but in the losses, the three losses they've had, they have had really problems on that line. And, of course, Duke University is not a team that overpowers you on the boards. What they try to do is just keep it neutral. Wake Forest Deacons, better perimeter shooting. This is a basketball team that gives up a big edge to Duke in regard to three-point shooting. They have to get that a little bit closer today. They usually count on that defensive-wise. And a balanced attack. Wake Forest in their last two losses have only had two guys in double figures. They've got to get a little bit more scoring, go a little deeper. They have on the year four guys that are double figure scorers, and they have to count on that today.
Carlos Boozer returns to the Duke lineup as he was given a brief rest. And we see for the first time Chris Duhon, the freshman who was player of the year in the state of Louisiana a year ago. He wears 21.
And Dawson in the Wake Forest game, so now you have a very potent scorer coming off the bench and a freshman who has become extremely hot offensively in the last three games in Duhon.
Sangayev, the Lithuanian, takes his first shot. And a battle won by Nate James. Here come the Blue Devils. 6-4 Wake.
So far, Duke has not been able to get their patent and pick and roll going from up top. Waiting for Battier to step out some.
James against Dawson hits hard, and the rebound goes to Battier. He misses, tapped out. Duhon sets up Williams, and he hits the three.
Vidaurreta probably committed two fouls on that last occasion against two different people, but for some reason, he does a great job with his feet and gets very few fouls called against him, even though he's extremely physical.
Vidaurreta fires and hits again.
Two for two.
He leaves Wake with six, and they're back in front by one. And a hold away from the ball. And Sangaya, who has had a problem with the early whistles that have really tempered some of the games in which he's played. He's fouled out five times this year.
Well, probably the most difficult situation he had is where he picked up his third foul at Virginia with Wake Forest in the lead and then had a technical foul, which was his fourth. And from that point on, Virginia controlled the game.
Battier left alone, and you can't do that. You pay the price, and it 3 points for the Devils, and it's 10-8.
Almost half of Battier's field goals are from three. So you have to play him out there almost like he's a guard.
Howard, the leading scorer for the Deacons, unable to get on track early. Dunleavy hawking him, and the shot is well short again.
Josh Howard taking some very difficult shots so far in this ball game. He's got to let the game come to him a little bit.
Duhon. Vidaurreta knocked it away. Oh, what a scramble, and it's won by the Blue Devils. And finally, a whistle and a held ball.
We're seeing a lot of physical activity in this game on both sides, and no whistle being blown by the official. Now, Duhon got scratched, it seemed, in the eye on that entry pass, and now he's holding that eye.
Before the scramble, it was out in the perimeter.
You see it right here is where I think he gets hit in the eye, but he made the play, and he tried to throw that ball on the inside, but I think that's where he got hit, not when he dove into the pack.
But he took the worst of it in that football-like scramble
looks
for the
like
loose ball.
Looks like it's his nose, not his eye, now that they're attending to. And you'll see right here, Howard will come scrape right across his face, hit him right in the left eye. And he's still down there for a while. And the thing that's so interesting about him, in 35 minutes against Virginia, he had 20 points. That was his first breakout offensive game. And you think about him really stroking it. Although he was 6-for-8 against Villanova with 17, that Virginia game meant something. Then he followed up with 15 at St. John's, and then 10 against Virginia Tech.
And the thing about him, Billy, his three-point shooting in the last five games, 58% from outside the arc, 14 for 24. So he's really, as they head toward the tournament time, Duhon has become an important piece in this Mike Krzyzewski team.
Without question. And Dick, one of the things that it makes them so flexible is before this, he was spelling Williams and primarily as an assist man and the defender. But now he comes in there not only to spell Williams, but also to be in the backcourt at the same time with Williams with his great shooting ability that he's now expressing. It makes Duke really tough.
It appears nothing serious with Duhon, but shaken by he's slap in the face.
Yeah, he's squinting the it is the eye, and he's just trying to squint to get it to open up a little bit for him.
Battier in the corner. James, well short. Vidaurreta, his presence really, this senior being felt today, is high for the year of 7 points, and he has six already in this half.
Some guy posting up down inside on Boozer.
Howard around Williams, takes the 10-footer. That's the first good look he's had.
Well, it's a nice matchup for him because he can shoot right over the top of Williams. And Howard, as I said, is becoming one of the emerging stars in this league. Wow, Boozer and Vidaurreta really banging inside.
Tied at 10, Williams with a tough turnaround 12-footer from the baseline, and he has five. Shows by a basket.
Shows some versatility there, Dick, when you can shoot that turnaround jumper. And a great steal by Williams on the crossover.
Howard to beat. And the follow as James hustles down court to convert, and Duke leads by four for the first time.
I think if you're Dave Odom, you want this pace a little slower. Duke would love to play up and down this court all day long. Wake Forest has to get a little better shot selections.
Sangaya has his first basket, a 14-12 Duke's lead.
Obviously, Wake Forest used to playing against good competition. They're not intimidated at all at the start of this ballgame.
Dunleavy, great ball handling skills at 6'9", knocked away, but no whistle. And out of bounds to Wake Forest, the call.
Vidaurreta has been amazing. That was another foul, not called. I think he's the invisible man out there. It's amazing what he does with his body.
Just the way I taught him, says Daddy.
No, I think his father's saying the same thing I am. Man, I believe that's a foul in Spain.
Wake Forest looking for the tying two or the lead three.
Hey, these referees are allowing a lot of physical contact.
That's to Sangaya's liking, member of the Olympic team, Lithuanian team that almost beat the USA twice. O'Kelly takes it down the middle, and Vidaurreta loose ball to Sangaya. Double team, gets it in anyway, and it's tied at 14.
Sangaya, an excellent basketball player, powerful on the inside, and has had some good games against Duke in the past.
Foul on Sangaya.
He will draw the fouls. At 116 fouls as a freshman, has fouled out a number of games.
Heat, heart-stopping excitement. David Letterman, Surviving the Late Show. Monday, don't miss Kimmy, the latest Survivor castaway.
As we look ahead to the upcoming March Madness, the old RPIs come to play, Billy Packer.
Well, it really is an important indicator of what the committee will eventually think of teams. And look at Kentucky. Look at Georgia. These strength of schedules really coming into play. Penn State, those are some surprises that I see right there of teams that are a lot higher than maybe the average fan would think. California, Creighton also on that list. But they get a lot of credit for the quality of teams they've played against and how they've played on the road.
Back to action, 11:28 left in this first half. Tied at 14, and a blocking foul on Dunleavy as Josh Howard goes down with him.
Howard, a terrific defender as well as his offensive skills, and there was a case where Dunleavy had to allow Howard space in which to come down. Howard has the right to come down on that leap. Excellent defensive play. Howard has 52 steals. That was his 53rd on the year.
Josh Shoemaker, the big center, able to hit a three. And it's Wake Forest by 17-14.
Well, he is now 50% from three, 2 for 4 on the season.
Senior from Gate City, Virginia.
Pretty nice matchups out here in terms of size combinations for these two teams. Howard is very versatile, kind of like Battier, and brought a lot of different people.
Don Levy, you worked off the dribble to get that jumper, and it's 17-16 Wake.
And so far, defensive pressure at least full court. It's not been effective for Duke, with the exception of Williams' singular steal. Dawson hasn't gotten on track, but I can assure you, he's an explosive scorer.
Wide open from outside, and another three, and this time it's Antoine Scott, the junior from New Bern, North Carolina, and the Wake fans on their feet.
And that's Scott's first three on the year, so if you're the Duke assistant coach, Johnny Dawkins, and you say on the scouting report, you go ahead and let Scott and Shoemaker take the threes, and they bury two in a row.
Is your team a lock for the tournament seed, or they're one of those bubble guys? Well, find out by clicking on an NCAA Hoops at the Internet's home of college basketball, cbs.sportsline.com, or AOL keyword, CBS Sportsline. Mike Dunleavy toes the line. Josh Howard picked up his second foul. So Sangaia and Howard, two starters for Wake, have two.
Dunleavy, of course, in the first game against Wake, had a big night with 21 points, 7 rebounds, and 3 assists. Shows you how versatile this young man is. In that game, Howard did not play for Wake Forest. Williams had some problems, a foot problem, and Nate James was having some problems with the flu, so not everybody in full strength, but that's not the case today. Here comes the double-team pressure. Williams doesn't get there in time.
The blocking foul on Williams, who has just returned along with Carlos Boozer to the Duke lineup.
Mike Krzyzewski starting to show some irritation with the officials, and nobody works him better than he does. he doesn't mind that first half tee, but he's really on him.
Other scores from around the country at the bottom of your screen. Slam.
Does anybody remember Grant Hill in Kansas?
Dunleavy for three, and he quiets things at the moment. 22-21 the score.
Well, if you haven't seen Josh Howard play, you're going to get an example of what that young man can do.
Carlos Boozer a foul away from the ball, his second.
No block out, but watch him go above the rim, throw it down with the left hand. Maybe not quite as important at the time as Grant Hill's, and maybe not quite as spectacular, but man, he was up in the air.
Wake Forest by one with 9.5 left in this first half. Picks off by Williams.
Got to be careful. He can't beat Williams off that dribble, and that crossover is going to get him in trouble.
Duhon is okay. He's back in the lineup. He's on Howard. Picks with a much bigger defender, Dunleavy.
Howard would like to post up Duhon inside.
Six on the shot clock. Howard again. Josh Howard, who grew up nearby at Glenn High School, very near the Wake Forest campus.
He and Duhon are two outstanding players matched up, but Howard really has size on him. There's Williams, answers with a three.
They rain threes in Durham, North Carolina, and we're tied again at 24. 8 points for Williams. Nice move inside by Broderick Hicks for his first basket.
These teams, wow, there is Boozer with an elbow and drives Hicks to the floor. This game, Dick, on both ends, is very poorly officiated. They are allowing much too much contact, and I think the athleticism of these teams are getting away with these officials.
O'Kelly for three, and what a three-minute stretch here. Both teams with red-hot shooting, and Wake takes the lead by three.
improve all.
Welcome back to Kingsburg with Billy Packer, Wake Forest, and Duke. And the Deacons with a 29-24 lead, and 3 points have been the style on both offensive ends, as Duke now is 4 for 8 and Wake is 3 for 4.
That's what we talked about in our keys. Wake Forest can't allow Duke University to open up a big wide margin on that perimeter, and so far today they're doing a good job with it.
Battier can't get inside.
Nice job by Scott. There's the switch on the outside.
Rattles off for Williams. A rebound underneath by James. Taken away by Shoemaker. Boy, they are swallowing the whistle. O'Kelly streaking into the offensive end. Oh, almost overpowered Scott, who then throws it away.
Scott got hit right on the knee.
Official timeout.
And with it, a timeout. 7:36 left before the intermission. Welcome back with our game summary. 29-24, Wake Forest leads as the Deacons have made 7 of their last 8 field goal attempts.
I think here's a case where O'Kelly has got to see the floor. Now he has Dawson, who's an outstanding three-point shooter, 40%. Instead, he makes the tough play in here. If he hits Dawson, Duke has to come out. The ball goes inside, and it's a much easier play. Tough pass on the wrong side. Scott throws the ball away after getting hit on the knee.
He was handcuffed by that bullet pass from short range.
And he was in excellent position to go for an offensive rebound had they gotten the ball to Dawson, who, as I said, is right at 40% from three on the year.
Casey Sanders back in the lineup for Duke. Battier. Scott on him. Battier loses the handle, but no, they call a travel on Battier. No basket.
Pretty good matchup. Scott doesn't mind handling Battier on the inside. When you look at the size of these players, Howard and James match up nicely.
Vidaurreta back in for Wake Forest. O'Kelly with a seat.
Battier on Vidaurreta, knowing now he's going to be in arm warfare right out there, boy.
Howard. Rebound Dunleavy. Out to Battier.
A little bit of a floater by Howard that time. His shot selection has not been the best in this game.
William goes around to Hicks and has the basket and the foul. With the conclusion of today's game, we'll select the Chevrolet Most Valuable Player of the Game from each team. Chevrolet makes a contribution to each school's general scholarship fund, a grand tradition for 30 years.
Young man on this line, most valuable player in last year's ACC tournament as a freshman.
Already over 1,000 points in his 2 years at Duke, and he rattles in the three-pointer. It's 29-27, Wake Forest.
Duke knocked off Wake Forest in the semifinals last year, sending Wake on to the NIT, which they won.
Other scores, key games around the country. A runner, tough shot for Greg Dawson. He's finally in the books with his first basket.
But what he did, he crossed up James on that. James looking to stop him from shooting that jump shot outside. He put it on the floor, unlike what Kelly did against James. Good back screen. Everything comes to a stop when it gets to Williams, and then Duke gets reorganized. It's amazing how they look to him and how well he delivers.
Down to 7 on the shot clock. Williams just took a look at it, has it stripped away. Antoine Scott with a defensive play.
Great job by Scott just to stay in front of Williams.
Look at Hicks fly in, and boom, does he run in to Sanders. The foul before the shot. Jason Williams, and that's his second for Duke.
Now, Hicks is a player that's given another dimension to Wake Forest as well, because he's much more offensive-oriented than what had been the case with Irvin Murray, who was the starting point guard and really did not look to shoot. So Wake becomes more explosive, particularly since Hicks is now starting to look not only for the jumper, but the penetrating moves.
We'll see if Mike Krzyzewski gives Williams a rest with 2 fouls as Hicks makes his first free throw and has 3 points in the game. Boozer returns, so does Duhon or Duke. Sanders out, and so is Williams.
But you see also what Mike Krzyzewski is starting to do with Sanders is get the playing minutes. It's not important that he become productive with his scoring, but it gives minutes and allows Boozer to sit down, rest, and stay out of foul trouble.
33-27, a six-point Wake Forest lead. As Wake off the bench, outscoring Duke 9-0.
Boy, Mike Krzyzewski is really hot. There comes the technical, and I knew it was coming. He has been on these guys for the way they're calling this game.
He's furious. Look at, he went all the way around his huddle to go to the other side to continue the debate.
Well, I'm going to tell you, Dick, what he's doing right here, you have two officials that normally don't work the Duke caliber games. And he doesn't like what he's seeing out there, and he is going to let him see it. There was the trip. No call made. Dunleavy being very smart and getting the timeout.
Well, while the blood pressure lowers for Coach K, we'll remind you of 96 Midwest Regional Semifinal, Minneapolis, the Nextel Tournament favorite, Wake and Louisville. Dave Odom saw Tim Duncan, the All-America, score 27, grab 13 rebounds, block 7 shots, a 3-point shot, and then a 3-point play for Duncan, and a 1-point Wake Forest lead. The Cardinals, DeJuan Wheat, missed the shot as time ran out, and Wake celebrated a 60-59 win over Louisville.
Duncan, a two-time ACC Player of the Year, was first to do that since Danny Ferry, and now those two guys find themselves as teammates.
That technical foul called against Krzyzewski is the first against Duke all year.
He was baiting these guys for about 6-8 minutes. Trying to get their attention on the physical nature in which this game is not being called.
Dawson, only a 66% free throw shooter, hits the first.
That's kind of surprising that Sangaya, who is an outstanding free throw shooter, was not called upon to do so.
So 34-27, Wake Forest's biggest lead with 5:54 left in this first half. Duhan now runs the Duke offense with Williams on the bench. He has Dunleavy, Battier, James, and Boozer. It's the lob pass to Boozer and the easy two. That's worked a couple of times for Duke. 6 points now for Boozer.
Wake Forest playing in front of the low post position because they don't want it to go in and kick out for the three.
Tough luck for Hicks, who made a nice drive. Vidaurreta claims the rebound. Dawson from long range and is well off. Duhan. Right into Boozer again. James took his eye off the ball.
He really did, Dick. We were looking right at him, and he was looking as to where he was going to pass it before he caught it. And obviously, the first thing you have to do is get it in your hands.
Robert O'Kelly returns for Wake Forest, number four, and Josh Howard given a blow. That's the seventh Duke turnover.
Wake Forest getting good production off of this bench today.
Wake has only two miscues, only two turnovers. O'Kelly. Oh, stolen by Duhan.
That's great defensive play by Battier to help out. He'll take the three.
Down the bottom of the well. That's his spot. Dead center.
That was a mental mistake by Wake Forest. Battier, the trailer. If you're guarding him, you've got to go out and meet him. You can't let him assume he's going to come down inside.
Battier averages 19. He has 6 today.
Hicks ought to try to beat James with the dribble.
2-point Wake Forest lead here at Winston-Salem. 6:05 on the shot clock. Vidaurreta will take the shot. He hits again. The game of the year for Rafael Vidaurreta, the senior. 8 points. That's his season high.
And he seems very confident down in that right-hand corner, Dick. I mean, every one of them have just been total net cities. He hadn't hit the rim on any of them.
Under 4 minutes to go in this first half.
Battier wanting it down inside, but Shoemaker's a pretty good defender.
And Battier fights his way along the baseline for the basket and a foul.
And what we're seeing now, Dick, is the tremendous leadership that Shane Battier has. He realizes that the referees are not going to change the way this game is being called, and so he's telling his guys, let's get physical also. If they're not going to call it, both go after it.
Josh Shoemaker with his first foul, and here's one of the leading candidates for the Naismith and Wooden Award as the top college basketball player of the year, senior from Birmingham, Michigan. Battier with a three-point play, and Duke claws back to within one. Oh, the basket was not good. The foul was outside, so makes it 36-33. And Battier gets the two, and Duke is within two with 3:46 left in this first half. We welcome you back to Wake Forest, where the Deacons lead by two over the third-ranked Duke Blue Devils. Great to be sitting next to a Wake Forest hero, Billy Packer. There he is. Hero. He migrated from Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, to the South, and was
part of teammate Dave Budd, who was an outstanding player for Woodbury, New Jersey.
And here's that touch from outside by Packer, who averaged nearly 15 a game in his three-year career. And what a lot of you don't know, he also lettered in baseball as an infielder here at Wake Forest and was a member of the only Wake Forest team to go to the Final Four. In fact, you finished in third place. You won the consolation game against a team about to bud into greatness.
John Wooden in his first Final Four that he took UCLA to. And, of course, after that, he only lost one other time his entire life.
Len Chappell, the great scoring forward for Wake Forest on those teams of 60, 61, 62.
You know, something about Len Chappell's interesting. He's the only man in ACC history ever to average 30 points a game on the year. Is that hard to believe? In this league, all the great players they've had, and only one guy has ever averaged over 30.
And Broderick Hicks from NBA range was well short, but Wake Forest gets another chance. Leading by two, 3:25 left in this first half. And Hicks really pressured by Williams. Williams playing with two fouls.
A lot of body contact and hand checking contact allowed in this game. And here's Hicks. Boy, he has really changed the whole makeup of this Wake Forest offense, because he'll take it inside, plus he's got a pretty good jumper as well.
Averaging seven, and he has six today. Does Hicks, almost thrown away by Duhon. Battier working the baseline, has it knocked away. And there may have been a call. Well, they're now saying out of bounds to Wake Forest. Coming up on Singular at the Half, Greg Gumbel has all the scores and highlights, perhaps some of Coach K, plus a visit with Kentucky head coach Tubby Smith. He's really turned the Wildcat season around, winning eight in a row. That's all coming up Singular at the Half.
Hicks had 16 at Duke in a breakout game. He's at 14 in Maryland, 18 against Clemson. So he has changed things around, and there is a little bit of a makeup call down inside.
Vidaurreta picks up the foul, pushing Battier, his first.
With all of the banging and grabbing and pushing, you get a little touch call inside. So that technical that Mike Krzyzewski had earlier may be starting to work a little bit.
You saw the quizzical stare from Dave Odom at the other bench.
Well, he will have to get in this action as well now.
Dunleavy goes to the line as Duke now in the bonus situation. And the Deacons see Dunleavy miss the front end. Vidaurreta rebound. Hicks flying. Oh, he is quick, and what a block by Sanders.
And look at him run the floor looking for the lob.
Williams will take the three. Oh, boy, can they shoot the tray or what? 38-37 Wake's lead.
Boy, Sanders can really run. And these Duke kids right now and the Wake players are really going after each other. This is a physical hand fight.
Almost thrown away by Scott from the side. Well off is Kelly. Kelly and Dunleavy, boy, how is he maintaining the dribble through three Wake defenders?
Particularly at 6'9".
Duhon. Oh, the freshman with a slam, and Duke reclaims the lead, 39-38. Timeout, Wake.
Good timeout call by Dave Odom here. He wants to slow down. Duke is known for going on 10-0 type runs.
And and it's Duhon flashing for the two. Come back, one of the top teams in the nation, the Duke Blue Devils, with a one-point lead here at Wake Forest. Well, we talked about the surprises, Billy, in the RPI rankings. Here are perhaps disappointments.
Well, Maryland has not been able to, until this last week, starting to win some games against good people. Gonzaga playing extremely well. That seems to be awful low for them. Florida's non-conference schedule probably hurting them a little bit. Alabama on the road having problems. Virginia, I think, is about where they ought to be.
We talked about the defense for Wake Forest, especially against the three, 29% leading the ACC. But today, Duke is 6-for-11, 55%. And now have a one-point lead. Wake Forest with 1:35 left in the half.
Sanders wants playing time. You could just tell the intensity and the look on his face.
Vidaurreta and Battier, and a steal by James. Again, closing off the passing lanes. Duke does that so well.
Nate James has some long arms too, Dick. I think that that 6'5", he plays a lot bigger than that.
Duhon running the show, almost stolen by O'Kelly, but he forces the turnover as it's deflected off Nate James. Thursday on CBS, a reminder, man's best friend becomes a criminal's worst nightmare. We'll give you more on that later.
Dick, that was a turnover on James, but that was really a bad decision by Duhon to throw that ball. It was too much space.
Final minute. Wake looking for a basket to take the lead at the intermission. Good pass inside. Scott gets the bounce. 40-39 Wake Forest with 34 seconds left.
Scott's an offensive player.
Shot clock is off. Fans on their feet.
Scott ought to go ahead and get close to Battier, try to pick up the five.
Duhon with 12.
Let's see what Duhon can do in the spot that Williams normally has.
Duhon with five. Inside to James, and he gets the basket at the buzzer.
There's a fifth-year senior for you, having the presence of mind to be able to put it away.
Nate James gives Duke the lead at the break. And Mike Krzyzewski with a final verbal volley at the officials as Duke leads it 41-40. That's the first half here at Winston-Salem. Now let's go to New York and Greg Gumbel.
Coming up on Singular at the Half, we'll get you caught up on scores and highlights, and we'll talk with Kentucky head coach Tubby Smith. After a slow start, his Wildcats are on a roll. That's all next, following this message and a word from your local station.
CBA Sports presents Singular at the Half, sponsored by Singular, the wireless company that believes in the value of self-expression.
Welcome back to our New York studios in Singular at the Half. Our score after 20 minutes of play in Winston-Salem is just a one-point game. Duke, the national leader when it comes to winning margins at almost 24 points a game. They lead by just one at halftime, 41-40. Elsewhere on the college basketball scoreboard, Big Ten action in Indiana. The Hoosiers lead at 38-29 at halftime. Watch Indiana's Kirk Haston with a long three over the outstretched Badger defense, and the Hoosiers led by 10 early on. Indiana's Jeffrey Newton will kick it out to Coverdale for the wide open three, and the Hoosiers stretch their lead. And then Indiana's Jared Jeffries will hit Newton with the lob for the dunk. And the Hoosiers lead it by a score of 38-29 at halftime. In the SEC, in Gainesville, the Florida Gators with a 42-38 halftime lead on Alabama. Florida's Brett Nelson will pull up and hit. And Florida takes the lead by two. Alabama comes back with Grizzard with his second straight three to put the Tide on top by three. But Florida's Ladarius Halton up with the loose ball out to Orion Green, who takes it for the layup. And at halftime right now, the Gators lead the Crimson Tide 42-38. In Washington, Big East battle between Syracuse and Georgetown. Under 2 minutes to play, the Hoyas lead it 70-59. Georgetown's Demetrius Hunter, the drive and a monster jam in Georgia, or Georgetown up early. And Syracuse Keith Dwayne with a three-pointer to cut the Georgetown lead to two. But that man Hunter the three-pointer to break a tie and give the Hoyas a three-point lead. And then Hunter, the second of two straight three-pointers. He has 19 in the game so far. And Hunter now up to 20 points on the day. 70-59, Georgetown with a lead, under a minute to play there. In Nashville, Tennessee leads Vanderbilt at halftime, 39-28. Tennessee looking to snap a five-game losing streak. And Dayton at Temple, the final score there. Temple over the Flyers by a score of 70-62. Temple has now won six of the last seven meetings between these two teams. Here are the results from the week's CBS Sportsline Top 25 Fan Poll, presented by Agilent Technologies. Ohio State at 21 made a statement this week by knocking off Illinois. UCLA now 12. The Bruins will have a rematch with Stanford next Saturday here on CBS. And the top five, defending national champ Michigan State, Illinois, Duke, Stanford, and North Carolina. As always, we remind you to vote in next week's poll at cbs.sportsline.com. AOL users enter the keyword CBS Sportsline. Later this afternoon here on CBS Sports, we will send you out to Southern California for live third-round coverage of the Nissan Open. With more on the action unfolding today at Riviera, here's our man in the tower at 18, Jim Nance. CBS continues at 1 Eastern time as Arkansas hosts number 16, Kentucky. Earlier today, we had a chance to talk with the man who led the Wildcats to the national title in 1998, head coach Tubby Smith. This year's squad endured a rocky 3-5 start, but now rides an 8-game winning streak. I asked him about his team's troubles and the subsequent turnaround.
Well, Greg, we were a very young team, and it was the earliest that any team has ever started a season. We started November 9th in the Coaches versus Cancer Classic up in New York at Madison Square Garden, playing against a good St. John's team who had three seniors returning off of one of the best seasons they've had in a long time. And we have seven new faces. And since that time, we started to get better because kids improved. Their skills improved, their shooting improved, and we had a chance to get to know one another.
Did you feel the heat at all? You know, everyone expects so much from Kentucky basketball. Rick Pitino became available. And I'm just wondering if that weighed on your mind at all.
No, not at all. I knew we were going to be a very good team, and certainly Rick was available. He was looking for a job. So the speculation was going to be there, and certainly we didn't get off to a very good start, 3-5, and that's something that we're not used to, and dropping out of the top 25. But no, those things really didn't faze me because I knew we were going to mature and grow up at some point in time this season.
You're leaving shortly for Arkansas. What are the dangers of playing the Razorbacks, especially at their home arena?
Oh, number one, leaving here, going to Arkansas. Anytime you think about going to Bud Walton Arena in the Fayetteville, you better be ready for a team that's going to come at you with everything. You know, they're very aggressive. They're very athletic. You really don't have a feel for who's going to play, and it's hard to prepare for a team that has so many different weapons.
Everyone points to the obvious teams to be wary of, Stanford and Duke and North Carolina. Any others around that you kind of have your eye on that you go, uh-oh?
Well, obviously Michigan State is the one that's coming on. Charlie Bell, we played them early in the season, and I think they're a team that could win it again. There are quite a few teams out there. Iowa State, you know, Larry Eustace has done a great job there. Tom Izzo at Michigan State. I mean, but once you get past, I would think, three or four teams around the country, I think there's a lot of balance and a lot of parity in college basketball.
Tubby Smith's Wildcats have won 15 of their last 17 games as they fly to Fayetteville for tomorrow's game. And at halftime of tomorrow's game, we will pay a special tribute to Dale Earnhardt, who lost his life on the final lap of last Sunday's Daytona 500. Thanks for watching Singular at the Half. Next, we'll rejoin Dick and Billy courtside in Winston-Salem for the second half between the Blue Devils and the Demon Deacons right after this.
Singular at the Half has been sponsored by Singular, the wireless company that believes in the value of self-expression.
Samantha.
A physical and sometimes frantic first half, and Duke leads 41-40.
Nortel Networks presents the virtual playbook.
Dick, one of the things that Duke loves to do is to set up in the box with Williams out in the top.
They have so many guys that can break out. In this particular case, Dunleavy goes out to the left. Then Battier, who could come out and screen or take advantage of a screen himself and slide out for the three, can hit it out there. And Duke University is so tough to guard in that set.
And ready for the second half with the Blue Devils up by one. Welcome back to Winston-Salem and a look at the autotrader.com halftime statistics. And Duke, true to form, using the three-point shot. They're averaging almost 11 a game. They made six that first half, Billy.
Well, Wake Forest doing a good job, though, not turning the ball over. They're getting good production off their bench. We talked about having that bench be productive for Wake Forest, and it is doing so in this ball game. I think the score indicates these teams very well balanced today, and this game has been extremely physical, Dick. It'll be interesting to see in the second half if the officiating changes a little bit more, particularly with the banging we've seen inside.
Sungai only played 4 minutes. The first half is on the floor for Wake Forest. They were led by Vidaurreta, 8 points and seven rebounds in the first half. Jason Williams had 14 to top Duke.
Sungai with 4 minutes, not very productive, but picked up two fouls in there, so that is something Wake Forest can ill afford. They need him on the floor. And he matches up nicely, whether it's with Battier or Boozer.
O'Kelly, Vidaurreta, Hicks, Sangaya, and Howard for Wake Forest. Sangaya trying to take it inside. Three men pick him up and steal it away. James.
He who hesitates is lost, Dick. And when that ball goes inside, you got to make your move quickly. That was a double team down, and you couldn't get rid of the ball.
Dunleavy fires a three, and the Duke Blue Devils, oh boy, they just fill their plate with those trays. 10 now for Dunleavy. Matches Duke's biggest lead of the first half, four. Howard, short, Boozer, rebounds.
Nice crossover. Howard felt he was nipped on the arm on that one. There's Williams just taking off.
Body checked, and Williams comes up holding his left shin as Hicks goes flying out of bounds. He has three fouls.
Williams is really, I don't know what he hit, but he is down and came flying through the air on that particular play. We'll see him right here. Oh, bang, knee to knee, and then goes down on top of that.
Leading scorer in the game, as he has been much of this his sophomore year, Jason Williams. He has 14. And that's a sight that Duke fans do not enjoy.
Well, 26, seven rebounds, and six assists against St. John's. Came right back with 25 points and six assists against Georgia Tech. And he is holding his head down there, certainly one of the premier players in the country.
He's going to make some All-America teams. A quick reminder, Thursday on CBS, from the co-creator of NYPD Blue and the co-creator of Miami Vice, comes the next great police drama. Ed O'Neill stars in Big Apple, premiering after CSI Thursday at 10, 9 Central on CBS. Don't miss it.
There were two hits right here. There's one, and then he gets hit the second time as he comes down. He got that knee hit right there and then came down as he went by Vidaurreta, getting up now, and at least he's walking on it okay. Talking about a tough kid.
There's not much meat there on that front of the lower leg, the shin, and he took full force there, and obviously very painful. We can all identify with that.
Well, it was almost one of those knee-to-knee jobs, and very painful when they hit, but it looks like he walked off all right. I think we may see him back in this ball game.
Chris Duhon, the freshman who was injured hit in the face in the first half, takes his spot, and a foul away from the ball. And
it's Sangaya's going to get the call.
Third.
That's his third, and he is amazing how in a game even called as rough as this one, he will be singled out. He and Boozer were in hand-to-hand combat. Sangaya gets the call against him.
Good steal by Hicks. Walk, but it's not called. And Vidaurreta up with another rebound.
Boy, this game leaves a lot to be desired, Dick, on both teams' standpoint in regard to refereeing.
And Sangaya has it knocked away. He takes it right back, scores, and he's fouled by Boozer.
Boy, Sangaya is fired up. This game is so physical. There's going to be a steal from down underneath. Watch, the guy gets it batted away here. No call made on that. Battier, who is very good at this, and Gaia just comes back and says, sooner or later, I've got to get a call.
Darius Sangaya. He was part of that Lithuanian team that lost 85-83 to the United States in the semifinals of the Olympics.
Well, I saw both of those games that Darius played against the United States team, and neither one were anywhere near as rough as this one.
Dunleavy takes it inside and sets up James for the three. Well short, knocked outside, and recovered by James, and then taken by Howard. Josh Howard all the way. And Wake Forest back in front, 45-44.
Great dribbling by Howard, and he really elevated at the end over Battier.
8 points for Howard, Wake's leading scorer on the season at 14-plus.
Wake Forest is in his zone. Howard didn't realize it, got out of position.
No foul as Dunleavy crashes in, misses the shot. Hicks. O'Kelly for three. Too long. Duhon the other way for Duke. Freshman wisely pulls it up, waits for the numbers, and there's Battier for the trade. Oh, my.
Wouldn't you think that players would realize that that's what Battier's going to do? Here's Williams coming back in the game. A little gimpy on that leg, but Mike Krzyzewski wants to get him in there before it cools down completely. See if he can go on it.
That's a ninth lead change as Duke is back in front by two, with 17-plus remaining in the second half. Hicks inside. Vidaurreta tries to power in, and Boozer and Battier were there. It'll be Battier with the foul.
Battier loves to block shots as they're on the way up. And there's Battier taking the three. Wake Forest out of position. You got to know where he is.
First foul on Battier as Jason Williams still holding that left shin. He was limping as he went to the scorer's table, but he's going to return. Vidaurreta. 8 points and eight rebounds for this senior from Spain. And Williams still favoring that leg. And Sanders comes out as, or Sanders is in as James out, and a Boozer will be rested as well.
And I think you can see where Duke University is going with their substitution pattern, with Sanders getting in there early in the first half, coming in here early in the second half. Mike Krzyzewski going to try to deepen that bench a little bit in this push for the NCAA tournament.
Sangai up for the rebound, and Dunleavy knocked it out of bounds, so two Wake after Vidaurreta misses the chance to tie. 47-45 Duke.
Nice hedge move by Sanders.
Howard with a size advantage over Duhon throws up a brick, and Dunleavy rebounds.
Howard's problem today, Dick, has been shot selection. When he has been patient enough to get a good shot, he's buried it. Nice pump fake.
Well, Vidaurreta slapping, even though he got a lot of ball. When you make that kind of defensive move, you're going to get the whistle. It is his second.
Well, Vidaurreta, inside 12 feet, uses his feet extremely well and his power well. But when he's forced to go outside, as Battier created that time, he really is not a good defender from 15 feet extended.
Shane Battier had his number 31 retired earlier this week. Duke home game.
One of 10 at Duke now.
Started with Dick Grote, a great basketball and baseball star. Went on to be a terrific infielder. Pirates, National League Baseball.
World Series man.
Battier gives Duke a four-point lead at 49-45. He now has 13. Hicks, tough angle.
Roderick Hicks.
Roderick Hicks 6 over his average on the season, now has 8.
And what Hicks was trying to do there is to draw the foul, made the shot anyway.
Oh. Rebound, Howard. Numbers aren't there, 3 Duke men are back. Hicks again, boy, he is determined to drive to the hole, and Vidaurreta rips it out. O'Kelly, 3, yes! And it's Wake Forest by 1.
Here we have Vidaurreta and Battier have been going at it, and Vidaurreta puts him on the floor and gets the call. This game
could be a double foul.
Foul is called on Josh Howard.
No, it's on Howard. And for Howard, his 3rd.
I blame all of this, Dick, on the officials, however. They have never been in control of this basketball game, and it's hurt both teams.
The basket counted, and now Williams fires. Rebound, Vidaurreta. Embraces it. O'Kelly hurries it into the offensive end. One thing about this Wake team, Billy, and you've watched them during the year, they have been, the guards have been so aggressive to the hole.
Now look at the banging in here, and there is Howard throwing Battier to the ground. Amazing.
We'll be right back.
Jack Mannion's got one last chance to win back the woman he loves.
Do you want to go one more round with me?
Gene Smart guest stars, The District, CBS Tonight.
There's Jason Williams, the leading scorer in the game from Plainfield, New Jersey. The word is he injured his calf, although he held his shin. The defense saying that he bruised the calf muscle. It's not a joint injury, and therefore he's back in ready to go. With the score, 50-49, Wake Forest in the lead, and they get the ball. O'Kelly, he sets up Dawson, and that's his shot, a three-pointer for Craig Dawson. He has 6, and Wake now by 4.
Good job by O'Kelly, breaking off of that screen. Dunleavy had to go ahead and help out a little bit, and Dawson just held his ground beyond the perimeter mark. There's that switch now. Big advantage, Williams.
And that'll be against Jason Williams for the charge. He now has 3.
Probably penetrated one dribble too many there, Dick. But he had Shoemaker on him, and he knew he could break him down with that dribble.
18-2 off the bench in Wake's favor.
And Wake getting very aggressive play from their guards right now. O'Kelly looking for his shot.
Inside to Sungaya. And loose ball to Duhon. Williams Dunleavy fires for 3. Duhon with the big boys pulls it down, and he is stripped but fouled.
Is that Sungaya's 4th? All he has to do is touch somebody, and they will find number. There it is.
He gets it's a 2 amazing. Off the bus. He gets 2 coming off the bus.
And he better watch it now. He's so frustrated, and you don't blame him in a way. This game has been so rough, and any touch he makes is a foul. It's amazing what happens to that kid.
That is, considering what we've seen, yeah. That wasn't called a remarkable foul against him for his 4th. Josh Shoemaker unable to save. It's 53-49 Wake Forest here at Winston-Salem. 14-42, and Sungaya, the number 2 scorer for the Deacons at 13.5 a game, on the bench with 4. Unable to contribute much in this game.
Nice turn and face by Boozer, nothing there.
Williams, a little off the mark, and Battier gives the Duke another chance. Williams takes it inside, he's blocked, no foul there.
That was Howard. They're kind of mirror imaging each other as to how they're going up and down this floor. Dickon hits.
Antoine Scott, the athletic junior, he has 7. Boy, he's a good player. Averaging 7 on the season.
He had 11 at Duke last year.
Battier with Shoemaker inside to Boozer, and Boozer, nice setup from Battier, and a foul.
That's the 3rd time today that Duke has been able to go over the top, with Wake Forest trying to overplay on Boozer, and these have been very good entry passes.
Dawson's first foul, Billy.
Nice and patient by Boozer that time. Knowing he had position, seals his man, and then a perfect pass from Battier. Nicely done.
From the state capital of Alaska, went to Douglas High School in Juneau, was a McDonald's All-American, converts the three-point play, and now has 9 in the game. Dunleavy, given a rest. Duhon back in. Game has seesawed throughout. It's now 55-52 Wake. Hits. Duhon up high over his teammate Boozer to claim the rebound.
And with no fear. I mean, they're going into the pack on both teams.
Duhon sets up the move.
O'Kelly
is fouled. Boy, that was clever. Use the left hand, left hand, left hand, and then shot to the right and up the lane. Next, the PGA Tour on CBS rolls on with live third-round coverage of the Nissan Open from Los Angeles, California. And Scott Dunlop with a one-shot lead in the third round with Davis Love, Tway, Barlow, and Jimenez just a shot back.
Mike Krzyzewski telling us before the game that basically this young man has now had the green light. And why he has developed so well is that in practice he started looking for his shot. Earlier on this season, primarily was defending, giving up the ball, doing a great job from an assist standpoint. But in order to be a scorer, you've got to take the shots.
Free throw shooting has been the Achilles for Duke in the last 5 games, shooting only 59%. But today, they're 10 for 11 from the line.
And why that's so important, Dick, they make more than their opponents shoot. They go to the line so much more than anybody they play against. So it's just a cheap way to pick up a bunch of points.
Howard. And Wake gets it back. Hicks, who certainly played a fearless offensive guard position today, taking it to the hole.
Good decision on Hicks's part there. The screen wasn't what he wanted.
Dawson spinning away from Dunleavy. A tough two-pointer.
Led the state in high school scoring 2 years in a row, and he's got a smooth stroke.
8 points for Dawson. He was the top number 6 man in the ACC a year ago as a sophomore.
At 29 against North Carolina in here a couple of weeks ago. He can put some points up there. Nice move.
Boozer shooting around Vidaurreta for another slam. He has 11.
Vidaurreta was trying to fight around the outside on Boozer's left-hand side. The perfect pass by Dunleavy gave him the space.
57-56, Wake Forest leading Duke. Hicks has it knocked away, blocked by Battier. And controlled by Dunleavy. No, Wake Forest in a collision, and the call goes to the home team.
There are going to be some guys a little bit sore after this. See, just as Vidaurreta made the move to go up on the left-hand side, the pass was perfectly thrown. Boozer had him sealed off.
Vidaurreta out at midcourt. And now Hicks will set up the offense.
Vidaurreta, of course, missed the most of the beginning of this season with a knee injury. Really playing solid ball out here today.
Dawson pulls up and overshoots, but Howard right there for the two-pointer, and he's fouled.
Dunleavy out of position. Howard had him sealed on the inside for the offensive rebound. And then Dunleavy makes the big mistake. You can see right there was a foul, actually, before the rebound even took place. That wasn't called. It probably helped Duke. Had it been called initially.
Dunleavy's second foul sends Josh Howard to the line. Sophomores here in the ACC, the Jays. Josh Howard, Jason Williams, and Joseph Forte at North Carolina, averaging 21 a game.
And they can all play.
60-56.
Wake goes in that 2-3 zone. Battier will go look for a hole somewhere. There he is.
Inside to Boozer, another easy two. He is cleaned up on little shots inside. 13 for Carlos Boozer, his average.
Good smart play by Battier, realizing that that zone was really spread out. There was no help inside.
Inside to Vidaurreta. And traveling is called against the big guy.
Well, Dunleavy gave up a lot of power on that play, but moved his feet nicely defensively to draw that charge.
11-22. two-point game. Back at the Lawrence Joel Coliseum in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, 14,000-plus for this ACC battle. And Wake Forest with a slender two-point advantage, 60-58 over third-ranked Duke, and Duke with the ball.
Battle is what it's been, Dick, in every phase that you can think of. Hand-to-hand combat battle, basically.
Boozer has had some easy points inside, but Wake has done a good job. Well, Williams now weaving inside to tie it up at 60, and Jason Williams leads all scorers with 16.
That was a brilliant drive because he paced himself to get around Vidaurreta.
Oh, the move inside, not there for Dawson, and here comes Duke. The three, it's tied at 60 with 10 minutes 45 seconds left in this second half. The Blue Devils rank third and Wake Forest 22nd in the nation in a crucial ACC battle, and a foul inside, and we've had a very physical game, players hitting the deck on almost every possession, as Wake Forest knows that with a win against Duke today, they'll have an NCAA bid, probably will anyway, but that would secure it, while Duke is trying to catch rival North Carolina. They'll play them a week from Sunday in Chapel Hill, as there's the top two teams, and Wake Forest down at 7-7.
And Dick, what's interesting there, those top two teams can ill afford to lose, not only from a standpoint of the conference championship, but both of them sitting in a position now to be a number one seed in the NCAA tournament. So very critical games here.
Much at stake for Duke as well, as Josh Howard picks up his fourth foul, the leading scorer on the season for Wake Forest. So Sangaia and Howard, the top two scorers for Wake Forest, each with four fouls. Front end missed by Dunleavy. Boozer.
And no foul called here. It is unbelievable. This game is just so poorly officiated.
Mike Krzyzewski picking up the first technical of the year for Duke, as he finally had to let off some steam. Currently four fouls in this half on Wake and five on Duke.
What I admire so much about both teams, Dick, is that neither one has backed down. The way the referees are calling the game, you know, neither team has said, well, this is unfair. They both kept going after each other, and Boozer continues his aggressive play.
Still up there battling to keep it alive, and O'Kelly, one of the shortest men on the court, takes it away. Lining up for three, and it's Josh Howard.
Remember in the first half when O'Kelly threw the ball to Scott instead of hitting the man on the wing? He must have had that in his mind because that was a good, smart decision there.
Howard, averaging 14-plus a game, has 13 today, and it's Wake back in front by the tray.
Tough shot for Williams, particularly with a sore leg.
The James over the top. Dunleavy. On the baseline is the call, out of bounds to Wake Forest. And Mike Krzyzewski asking, well, no foul there.
Well, I thought that his player committed the foul first, James on the push, but that wasn't called. I think it's too late, Dick, to start trying to work these officials now. They've called a poor game. They're going to continue to call a poor game. You're just going to have to go out and battle your way through it.
But as you pointed out, at both ends, they've been consistent.
That's what I'm saying. And both teams have not backed down physically against the other.
9:27 left in this second half as O'Kelly sets up Hicks over the top, and Jason Williams the other way for Duke. He leads all scorers with 16, but he's not been the same shooter.
Absolutely
since injuring his calf earlier in this half.
Hadn't been as quick.
Ooh, a little elbow from Battier.
No call again.
Oh, boy. Battier comes back to claim the rebound. Oh, no whistles, and Williams scores. It's 63-62, Wake Forest. Talk about letting him play.
And particularly with the points of emphasis this year in regard to the rules, it's hard for the players to adjust, but give them credit, they really have. Great competitors out here.
O'Kelly nails a three, and the number eight score in Wake Forest history in his final home game sends Wake back up by four.
O'Kelly had been in terrible slumps when Wake Forest had the slumps of their own. And he's a key for him.
Big man's move. Carlos Boozer at 6'9". He's only 19 years old, the sophomore. He has 15.
And they're going to him now, Dick.
O'Kelly again. Flat shot, but saved by Vidaurreta. And they'll rewind the offense. 2-point game, under 8 to go. O'Kelly flashing inside. Can't get the finger roll, but can get the rebound.
Huge.
Dawson unable to. Vidaurreta rebound. Oh! Will not count. No basket. Whistle before the shot. You couldn't hear it with the noise here at Joel Coliseum.
Scott and Howard today have flushed two from way above the rim. Scott just picked that ball up and took it through.
He is 6'8", a junior. The foul is significant. Called against Jason Williams. That'll be the fourth foul on the Duke point guard and leading scorer. Vidaurreta fouled before the Scott slam, and Williams will be rested with four. Again, the basket did not count. The foul was on Vidaurreta on his tip, and then Scott, with all the noise, flushed that dramatic shot. Vidaurreta one out of two. So it's a 3-point game as Duke goes on the attack. And timeout called by Mike Krzyzewski with 7:33 left in this second half. ACC action at its physical best. And it's Wake by three.
It's time for...
I will say that this RPI is not the final analysis for the NCAA Tournament Committee, but it is a real good indicator here. And we can see North Carolina, Stanford, Duke, Kentucky really doing well, coming on so strong. Illinois with leading the Big Ten, and there's UCLA, Michigan State. The one that's surprising out of this batch is Tennessee, because with the slide they're on right now, game at Vandy, and I see where they lead Vanderbilt there, but they have been having their problems of late. It's very surprising to see them ranked as high as 10.
And welcome back with 7.5 left. Duke trailing by three. And the turnover. Hicks 3-on-2. To O'Kelly for three. He is fouled, and that'll be a three-shot foul.
Fouls are number 14.
I would say right now that the Wake Forest players, and Wake Forest has gotten much better production off the bench than Duke has, at least statistically. Wake Forest players inside seem fresher than do the Duke players. There is O'Kelly, shoots, no question. James hits him on the arm. O'Kelly goes to the line.
James' first foul. O'Kelly with 11 points in the game. That was his first free throw attempt. One of the three seniors here on senior day at Wake Forest.
ACC Rookie of the Year in his freshman year. He was a prolific scorer his first 2 years and then got into a drought. He's dropped off considerably since.
Right at his average today, just under 12 a game. He hits one out of three. And it's a 4-point Deacon lead as the Blue Devils go on the attack.
And Jason Williams on the bench.
This freshman, Duhon, has matured before our eyes this season.
But in this kind of position, at least by the 5-minute mark, if Williams can go, he needs to be out there.
Inside to Battier, blocked by Vidaurreta. And O'Kelly is fouled. As the reach in on James, his second.
You know, Vidaurreta is not going to be any all-conference player, and he's not going to go on to some other level, probably go back to Europe and play, but today, in senior day, he has made his presence felt.
His parents from the north of Spain are here. They came to one game last year, celebrate their son's final senior home game.
The first a player from Spain that did well for Wake Forest, Ricky Perel, played a few years ago.
5-point Wake Forest lead, their largest lead 7. That came late in the first half. Duke has led by as much as 4. 70-64. Wake Forest opens a 6-point lead at the 6:47 mark, second half. And welcome back to Winston-Salem, Piedmont area of North Carolina. And a look at our game summary. It's interesting, early in the game, you pointed out, Billy Packer, that Wake Forest best defending the three, and Duke, of course, best in the nation shooting the three. And Duke had its way in the first half, 6 for 11, but they're only 2 for 10 in the second half.
The other thing that really jumps out at you is Wake Forest has taken 16 foul shots, Duke 13. Now, Duke averages 27 free throw attempts a game. So you can see this game is being called very loose, and it really has fallen into the pattern that Wake Forest likes a lot better
Absolutely.
Than Duke does.
Absolutely.
They have a deeper bench. The game has been extremely rough, and Duke University has not gotten on the foul line where they actually make more than their opponents shoot.
Remember, Jason Williams, the leading Duke scorer, is on the bench with 4 fouls, and Battier with a train bounce, and he now with 15.
And Williams did not come in the game after that timeout, and I think, Dick, that maybe that leg is giving him some real problems.
Josh Shoemaker. Hicks, who has been one of the reasons Wake Forest has been able to maintain its lead. He's had a terrific game.
He really has, and it allows O'Kelly to be a real two guard being out here to shoot.
There he is, aggressively inside, and Vidaurreta has his season high, 11 points. In fact, that's only a 4 off his career high.
Well, Hicks has been the key man. He has kept up the aggressive play offensively for his team.
And defending Duhon at the other end. Battier to Dunleavy. Good ball fake. Won't fall. Vidaurreta, who leads in rebounds as well. He has 12 of those. What a game for him in his last home game. Shoemaker inside.
Well, he had a pretty good position, didn't he?
Dawson will.
Hutchinski goes another timeout here.
The biggest lead of the game, and they're on their feet in that Wake Forest student section. 9-point lead for the Deacons.
Check this out.
Express.
Like they were thinking about it from the beginning.
In the 1930s, they built their first safety test vehicle.
In 51, they patented front and rear crumple zones.
In 1960, they patented their safety steering system
and pioneered anti-lock brakes in 78.
In 1997, they built a more crash-compatible SUV.
Now they have vehicles with 8 airbags.
Because one thing has always been most important.
Thank you for holding customer support.
I just want to let you know I'll never buy anything from your company again.
I'm sorry, what can I do to help?
Help? I've called you guys 5 times, and every time I have to explain this problem over
right,
again.
No,
last time you asked me to fax my invoice, then I emailed you. You thanked me for writing?
Could you tell me exactly what the problem is?
The problem?
Hello?
Business as usual is the problem. Siebel eBusiness is the solution. Siebel, eBusiness for a customer-driven world.
Speed, reliability, performance. The qualities that won Lance Armstrong the Tour de France. Now, they're available in international delivery. Introducing Global Express Guaranteed from the U.S. Postal Service and DHL. Delivery to over 200 countries in as little as 2 days guaranteed. Now, you'll know which team to ride with.
From the co-creator of NYPD Blue and the co-creator of Miami Vice comes the next great police drama. The Big Apple premieres CBS Thursday after CSI.
CBS Sports.
have the conference tournaments just 2 weeks away, and then all of March Madness, the intensity of this game, no way you can reflect that in the game reset. But Wake Forest leading 75-71. Here's a no foul.
Yeah, here's Jason Williams making a great crossover dribble. Vidaurreta goes out, just chops him on down. No call on the play whatsoever.
Maybe these guys ought to read the rule book and understand that physical contact that creates an advantage for a player is a thing called a foul.
Inbounds to Boozer. Able to make this one, but battling away. And look at that Battier fight going out of bounds, and last touch by Battier.
Howard doing a good job. Both of these teams so aggressive. But Mike Krzyzewski sees a lot happening right here for his ball club. If this were to be a loss, puts North Carolina in the driver's seat definitely for the ACC regular season and number one seed in the tournament. But then in the NCAA tournament also has implications.
North Carolina to play at Virginia, then at home against Maryland, and then a week from tomorrow at home against this Duke team. Sangaya saddled with four fouls. Hits. A six-point lead for Wake.
And it says something for Wake to be able to do this basically with Sundaya, their number two scorer, on the bench for almost the entire game.
He now has nine. Dunleavy. Williams for three. Jason Williams. What a heart.
A fearless shot by Williams, and Dunleavy was looking everywhere to try to find somebody open.
24 for Williams to lead all scorers.
Great, tough, hard-nosed man-to-man by Duke. But Wake Forest has met the challenge.
Down to 10 on the shot clock as O'Kelly maneuvers against Williams. Williams with four fouls. Now at five, and timeout called by O'Kelly with four.
That's a good smart play by O'Kelly rather than throw it away. The possession is so important here.
2:18 left. A three-point game. Come back with a look at the CBS Sportsline stat of the game. See 2:18 remaining, and Wake Forest in front by three. Timeouts also there, and Wake Forest 27 bench points to only four for Duke. For complete game coverage, go to cbs.sportsline.com. That's part of the balance for Wake. The leading scorers, O'Kelly and Howard with 14, but off the bench has been so much support. 4 seconds, so Sangaya fires in a hurry and over the top to Boozer.
That was a better look than what they would have had if O'Kelly tried to put up a bad shot.
The three would tie it, but they go inside to Boozer, who fires it down at 77-76, and a foul.
Not only a brilliant play physically by Boozer, but a very smart. Now there again, no foul called. Vidaurreta comes back down.
There's a
that,
foul.
There were two fouls committed. One by Boozer to get open, and one by Vidaurreta to try to stop him. But why that was such a smart play by Boozer, he anticipated the contact coming from Vidaurreta and dunked it with two hands.
Three-point play for Boozer, and we're tied at 77 with 2:05 left. Seventh tie of the game. Oh, look at Hicks take it to the hole.
Have we seen a play where there wasn't at least one guy on the floor?
The Blue Devils' biggest lead, four. Wake Forest has led almost the entire game and had a 9-point lead with 5:24 left here in the second half. Now it's even.
Sangaya. Boozer wants that ball inside, and they had the perfect setup because they had Sangaya with four fouls on him.
Duhon passes up the three to take the two, and Howard climbs high for the rebound. And here comes Wake. I think 19 left.
Dick, Duke missed a great opportunity there. Sangaya with four fouls. He was on Boozer. They didn't get him the ball down low. He's been so effective down there.
And a 10-second violation against Hicks. Hawked in the backcourt by Duhon. Boy, that was a fast 10.
It sure was.
And the Blue Devils' Mike Krzyzewski calls time as Dave Odom wonders.
29. And Hicks is just trying to get his team set up. And there it is. Officials are right on it.
77-77. 72 seconds left. Duke and Wake Forest tied at 77. A typical Blue Devil comeback, down by nine with only 5.5 minutes left. They've rallied to tie and now get the turnover on a rare 10-second violation.
Right at with 1 second too much in that expiring in that backcourt, Hicks really didn't realize, because it was kind of a battle for the ball, and he was walking his way up court trying to get things settled down. He's a little bit upset, but it was the proper call.
Timeouts. Wake has two. Duke is without a timeout, and the possession arrow favors Wake Forest.
Boy, you challenge a champion, and Duke has stood up for it. And Wake Forest, however, has brought everything that they had against them. Wake Forest playing one of the strangest games of the year, beating Clemson last week after Clemson had knocked off number one North Carolina. They had them down 41-9 at halftime. So they are having quite a week here.
77 tie as we approach the 1 minute mark. And a foul on Josh Howard going for the interception. And that'll send Mike Dunleavy to the line. And I believe that's the 10th foul on Wake Forest. So that'll be two shots.
And,
Howard fouls out.
That's Howard's fifth. He had the right idea and was a step late getting there. Really hurts Wake Forest, because Howard is a guy that can create his own play when the offense breaks down.
The LA Open third round follows. 14 points Howard, or the LA Nissan Open, as Josh Howard right at his average, 14 a game, 11 rebounds is DQ.
And Mike Krzyzewski trying to steal a timeout that he didn't have, figured that Dave Odom would take a lot of time getting in that player for fouling out Howard, but Dave Odom quickly got Dawson in the game.
Dunleavy, whoa, was he off on that one. He's 2 for 4 from the line today.
Well, we pointed out earlier, in the games that Duke has lost, free throw shooting has hurt him.
And Duke leads 78-77. They've outscored Wake Forest 12-2 since Wake had that 9-point lead. Final minute. O'Kelly pulls up. Doesn't get the roll. Dunleavy pulls down the rebound with 50 seconds left.
Shows his versatility in traffic, going up there and grabbing off a rebound.
Williams patiently setting up the offense.
Spreading things out. And Williams, it's good to see him back out on the floor right now. And you have Duhon, the secondary rebounder, secondary ball handler.
The clock was off. The game clock was off for about 15 seconds. Williams, how did he hit that line drive? 26 point for Williams, the game's leading scorer, and it's a 3-point advantage for Duke.
The assistants from Duke University screaming at the shot clock operator for not turning on that clock.
Wake Forest calls time with 20.3 seconds left, but there should be less than that. Winston-Salem.
Dick, you'll see what happens with the clock right here. All of a sudden it stops at 38. Here you can see the shot clock going down, but the time clock freezes
four
at
seconds,
38.
About 4 or 5 seconds. And the officials are checking the television monitors, and will do what's right here. Probably reduce that to around 15. 16 seconds.
There you see again. There you have the 38 seconds. And he gets down to 38 and stops. But you can see the shot clock continues to roll. And what would you say, Dick? 4 seconds?
Well, it was 22 down to 16, maybe even 6 seconds.
Chris Collins, assistant at Duke, is just going crazy over there. But he needs to calm down. Here we see it. And watch the shot clock. One moving and one stopping.
It was at 22 when it froze, and it restarts at 16. So 6 more seconds should be taken off.
Five,
should be
4 at the minimum.
Right.
Yeah.
So it should be around 14 or 15 seconds left. Certainly adequate time for Wake Forest to get off a shot, but they need a 3 now, as Duke has opened that 80-77 advantage.
Very strange game when you look at the stats of this ball game. The tremendous bench scoring by Wake Forest. Duke's inability to get to the foul line, which they normally have such a huge advantage over their opponents. And now the coaches are being brought by the officials because Dave Odom probably going to be notified now. He's going to be at least four less seconds than he thought.
Billy Packer, let's go back to your comments at the very start of the game and the fact that the elite teams in college basketball have to win on the road. And Mike Krzyzewski's team, that's been one of the trademarks of his great success in Durham.
Without question. And as I mentioned, he had, 24 straight road games in the ACC before being defeated up in Charlottesville by Virginia. A great accomplishment in a tough league.
He's won 57 of the last 61 conference games, showing his dominance there. And his three losses this year, one to Stanford, two to Carolina, and two to Virginia.
Well, another thing that's kind of interesting in regard to this incredible record that he's been able to compile, in the last 4 years, Duke is 122-14. From 89 to 92, they won 123 games, so they have a chance today to equal the best stretch of four that they've ever had. Let's see how many seconds we're going to get here.
The game clock is being reset.
At 15.3, they reset the clock. 15.3.
What was that, 4 seconds? Wasn't it 23 that was up there?
It was 22 down to 15, so almost seven. But to win, back to underline, just the difficulty for any team to win on the road in a tense conference play, and no matter what the conference may be. And then to be able, and this is a typical Duke game, not that they're going to win, and Wake Forest still battling here to try to get a three and tie it. But down by 9 points on the road with less than 5.5 to go, and have outscored Wake Forest 14-2.
Roderick Hicks hit a three-point shot when Wake Forest looked like they were going to lose one to NC State to send the game into overtime. And let's see if he has that in him. Now they have really O'Kelly, a good outside shooter, Dawson, and Hicks.
And it's Dawson who will inbound the ball, and he's often a good man to track after you inbound the ball, hoping he can break open. Hicks with 10. O'Kelly with 9.
Going here. It's tied again.
Williams, somebody better stop his penetration.
Williams. Duhon. Oh! Duke wins again.
The freshman.
My, oh, my.
The freshman has the horn sound.
What a game. 82-80. Third-ranked Duke, as they did at Maryland, not quite as dramatically, battles back from behind and gets the winning basket in the final second.
What is so amazing there is that they were able to stop Jason Williams' penetration, which he does so well, but he found a freshman guard with an incredible play. Both of these teams battled today. Really no losers out here. There was O'Kelly coming up big. Now watch Williams. He's so tough to stop in the open area. Finds Duhon, and then a terrific shot. Wow.
10-foot runner off balance.
Mike Krzyzewski said, we have given him the green light. Well, he took it and buried it right before the red light came on.
He's the freshman from Slidell, Louisiana. His 8th point of the game. Duhon for Duke, the hero today.
Watch the red light. Boom. But it's after the green light, Dick.
And a heartbreaking loss for Wake Forest, who battled throughout and led throughout. And Mike Krzyzewski throws up the victory sign again.
Well, up at Maryland, when they won and beat Maryland, he went, wow, we won. He was just shocked. This one almost equally as shocking.
Chevrolet most valuable players of the game are Carlos Boozer, who had 20 points and tough inside for Duke, and Rafael Vidaurreta in his final home game, the Spaniard for Wake Forest. 11 points and a dozen rebounds. Chevrolet will make a contribution to each school's general scholarship fund to reward outstanding students for their academic achievements and to assist those in financial need. Whoa, my. So for Billy Packer, this is Dick Enberg. So long from Winston-Salem, North Carolina, where third-ranked Duke did it again. 82-80 over Wake Forest. This has been a presentation of CBS Sports, home of the men's. Conference NCAA Basketball Championship.
Time with Jason Williams, only heading into his sophomore year. So